Hello once again. I'm now going to spend some time with you. I want to find the words that might enter your minds and hearts and have you leave this room a different person. A person understanding just who you are, why you are here, and what this nation is asking of you. A person who is prepared to commit. Do what has to be done if he or she is to assist us, help seek to survive. I'm going to frighten you. I'm going to show you some things that will trouble you deeply. But I'm also going to tell you why we need not be afraid. Why, if all of us work together with you, there are ways for us to deal with whatever comes our way. You are so, so important to our nation. And I want you to understand that by the end of this talk of mine, engagement, I hope you will spend some time afterwards, alone perhaps, sitting in your room, thinking about it, and then make a commitment to yourself and our nation of how you will behave at this university. So that you can empower yourself, you're able to empower others. And I want you to find three or four friends and become part of a team. Because there will be days when you will be desperately challenged and you feel like, oh, I don't think I can make it. That's the day you need to reach out to those other friends and say, come, I need you. I need you to help me to overcome this feeling of fear perhaps. Understanding that I might not be adequate. It's just too hard. And if you do that consistently for the next 3 or 4 years, then I will have the privilege, sorry, I will have the privilege of capital part of the process. I will be in the audience watching as you walk across the stage, as you kneel before the Chancellor puts a tap on your head and says to you, congratulations. And you wear the colours of your faculty, your parents and others on great faith. You look upon them with great expectation. I want to start with a poem. You guys don't recite poems enough. Let's go learn the poems in school. Do you? Some of you do. This poem is about knowledge and education. This is all about. We are about knowledge. We are about education. We are about how you find out things so that you might be able to do things with it. This poem is called Caravan. And before I go there, I just want to give you a short insight into what the challenge of a university is. This is what we must do. We must preserve the best of the old knowledge, the best knowledge we've already created as a species. We must hold on to it. I gave an example yesterday to students to say, I've just had an operation on my throat. A month and a half ago, I had a very different voice. It sounded like Rod Stewart. You know any of that singer? It sounded like him. And I was very worried because there was a thing growing there. I was worried that it might be cancer. They went and they took it out and told me the day before yesterday that it's not cancer. So I'm fine. But what they did was based on knowledge that they already had. How to take this thing out, how to put it under a microscope and find out whether this kind of cell is in there or not. As a consequence of that, they could tell me they're okay. So the best of the old knowledge is to be honest. Sometimes the old knowledge, the deep cultural knowledge, knowledge about sharing, loving. And then we've also got to teach you, those people there responsible for that, the people who come and engage with you, they ask you to read a lot. They'll also ask you to ask lots of questions. They'll ask you to write a lot, more than you've ever imagined that you're going to be asked to do. Schooling, forget about it. What you did in high school is nothing compared to what you're asked to do. They'll give you a book today and say, I want to report from you in 2 days' time. So his eyes are snapping. and they will expect you to be alive and anxious and full of energy for this intellectual project that we're going to engage in. And then, so they're watching there. Then we're going to also ask you to go on being with us beyond the bachelor stage, into the honor stage, into the master stage, into the PhD stage, and become creators of new knowledge. Great knowledge that is not known to us. Knowledge that responds to the challenges facing us. Expect you to do that. And then lastly, part of what we do is to make sure that in what we do, we support our community's development. But the most important thing we do with respect to that is you. Within the 3 or 4 years, 5, 6, 7, 8 years, not 5, 6, 7, 8 failure, but 5, 6, 7 going to PhD years, you are with us. We want you to become the best you could be. So that when you go back into your communities, they have within them midst a source of knowledge. Someone who is able to engage with, try and communicate. Okay? So this is what this poem is called, Parallel. It's a ship. A man called Christopher Columbus. You know him, did you do it at school? No? Christopher Columbus. He was the captain of that ship, 3 of them that went to America from Europe. Sailed across the Atlantic Ocean and came to the Caribbean. And this is about a person who was there when they came, because he was living there. This was in 1492. And that person then experienced this new thing coming at him. A new thing. And how does he experience it? And this is what the poem says. There was an Indian man, or Indian man, who knew no change. In other words, his life was tranquil. Every day, more or less, the same things happened. Was strange content upon a sunlit beach gathering shadows. He heard a sudden, strange, commingled noise, looked up and gasped for speech. For in the bay where nothing was before, moved on the sea by magic. Huge canoes with bedding cloths on poles and not one oar, and fluttering colored signs and clamorous people climbing up. And he in fear, this naked man alone, his fallen hands forgetting all his shadows. His lips gone pale, knelt low behind the stone and stared and saw and did not understand. Columbus's doom-burdened caravels slant to the shore and all her seeming moves. He didn't know what he was looking at. He didn't know how dangerous it was going to be. He didn't realize it was the moment that would define the future of his culture, which would be destroyed. But he stood and he saw that because it was outside of his experience. They had no one to go to say, what's that? Help me to understand that. Because they all had never ever seen those things. They didn't know what those people were, what their motives were. And so they stood and they saw and they did not understand. These people are dangerous. We must try to defend ourselves in some way. As a consequence of which their culture is destroyed. So, that's it. To stand and saw and did not understand. And it's a dangerous space to be in, to not understand. Because if you don't know things, people can tell you anything. And if you trust that person, you might follow the advice you are given on the basis of what other person's explanation. People can play with your mind, they can twist, they can destroy you because you don't know, and you trust, and you take the lead. That's what university is all about. Universities say everything is up for you. Everything has to be looked at a second or a third or a fourth time. There is no truth established once and for all. So that is what you're going to learn. But more than that, you're going to learn why it's important to stand and see and understand. Why the future of your future and the future of this nation depends on you standing and seeing and understanding and helping others to do so. This is what they faced. These conquistadors came off that boat. And this is what they did to them. Killed them. They took them into slavery. Destroyed their communities. They didn't know. Here's another example of that. 1652. There's a song in Cape Town that says, 1652, on a windy day, Van Riebeeck and his crew came into Table Bay. You know the song? Jan van Riebeeck coming from the Netherlands with his 3 ships. And he comes ashore and leaves the Khoisan. They lived there. This was their home. They've been tranquil in that space. Everything had been comfortable. And suddenly these new people come. And they did not understand what was going to happen here. Soon as a consequence of this, they would be chased away. They would be hunted. They would be killed. They would be decimated because of the small box that they had no defense against. And their entire culture is undone. They stood there and did not understand what this was all about. It's the danger of not knowing. Our challenge is, how do we get you to know as much as possible? How do we get you to know to want to know things? And how do we get you to make sure that others get to know it as well? So, this is what happens across all of Africa. All of Africa, except for two areas. The colonials come, the Germans come, the Italians come, the French come, the Portuguese come, and you saw the Netherlands. And they occupy, see the different colors show where they went, and they took over. And they subjugated, they didn't come to say, hey, we want to help you with things. They came to take, they took people as slaves to the Americas, and they took whatever gold and other things they could find. They came to take, destroy them. And they began to suffer. And so what did that colonialism do? What was the consequence of the fact that all of Africa was controlled by other nations from Europe, powerful nations, by things like guns and horses, armor that people in Africa didn't have? So what did it do? Here is a map of the world, and it's to scale. What do I mean by that? I mean, Africa is the second biggest continent, and that's why it's bigger than that. The biggest continent, also the map and perspective, that's the biggest continent, Asia. Africa is a very, very big continent. And that map comes out of a computer. And we ask the computer things, and the computer responds to us by changing the map. For instance, if I was to say, computer, tell me about the best in soccer, nations in soccer, what would that be? This one would grow so big. Why? Brazil, eh? Argentina, Messi and those come. This would go big. That's Manchester United and Liverpool and all of those people. And this would disappear. This one would I must correct. I went to watch a final play against Denmark the other day. And they played well. They played brilliantly. Ball control, the holding, short passes, very good. Until they get to the penalty box. Until they get there. So every other part of the field, they're very, very nippy. I was very impressed. But they don't want to shoot. For some reason. So I asked some young people one day about this. I said, what's with Fofana? That they look so nice, but they don't score goals. He said, because we like them looking so nice. We like to see the kicks more than we like them. Other religious things, long passes, very good. And so when they do the six, everybody's, hey, no, Jack runs up, pulls the ball back, like, hey! And the coach is shouting, shoot, shoot, take, take, take. They are now learning and beginning to accept that while their culture was the culture of fancy work, it's not a winning culture in soccer. You've got to get the good through pass, the man runs on short trees. Something that you have to give up as you've learned to do things. So, but I'm not interested in soccer. I'm interested in knowledge, education. What did colonialism do to Africa as a consequence of occupying it and not giving the people there the opportunities to advance intellectually? Not bringing new schools, universities. What's the problem? I asked a question about primary school children in the world. Where are they? How many are they? So what does it tell them? It says to me, China has got hundreds of millions. India has got hundreds of millions of youngsters. Africa's got it slow, and it looks at those relatives. Now I ask you the second question. I say, how many of those children stay in school and move from primary to secondary? You got it? And I asked that to the computer, and this is what it said. Have you noticed something? But Africa, it's gone smaller. What does it mean? Are we losing large numbers of children who don't even enter into high school? Yes. Now I'm going to ask it a question that you have direct interest. You're going to have a direct interest in asking, what about tertiary education? There. Ah, what does that tell you? It tells you that in this country here, large numbers of people go to university. In that country there, large numbers, look at that, go to university. Africa is not reaching, actually. We're not in this game. We We're not in the stand, see and understanding game in a big way. We're not telling our people, hey, we're going to supply all of this knowledge. All of you know your work, just come here. Work your way through. Become doctors. We're not in that game. Now ask about science research. Who researches in science in the world? Do that. Do you know this country gets the United States? It's got about, I think about, it's about 20 submarines, nuclear submarines. In the water somewhere, nobody knows where they are. But they stay there months and months and months underwater. Well, that submarine has got 12 Trident missiles. And on the shore, it's got 20 nuclear warheads. And those together can blow up all of South Africa, all of it, from the middle of the Atlantic. They don't even have to come and face you. From the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, they can drop those bombs on this building. That's the power of the technology there. And we say, come, we can do it. Stand, see, understand. They are so powerful because of what they've done with technology. The technology they've created. How do we engage with them? How do we, oh, not only in the world, how do we contest with Samsung and Hyundai and others when they are all completely committed to this knowledge project? Huge universities, lots of people, great activity, seriousness about it. And out of that comes all of these different inventions. So here we go to new patents. You know what a patent is? If I make a new car, and then I go and I register it as my car, and nobody else may make that car because it's my head's patent. Look at Africa's patents. What does it say? It says our culture is not creative. It's not making new things. It's standing still. It hasn't got the capacity to make those things. It doesn't have the brain power to make those things. The potential is there, but it's not finding expression. Isn't it actually coming to the fore? Look at Japan. It's a small country. Show you in what it looks like. That's its size. And look at what its size is on new papers. Everybody's in the paper. They say a child is born, they give the child a dummy. 10 days later, the child is ready to share it. He wants to make this dummy. It's a culture. It's a way of being. It's a way of being inquisitive. Wanted to do so. Wealth growth. We say ANC government, build us houses. ANC government, healthcare. ANC government, universities, free universities. We make demand and demand and demand and demand on this government who's only got a small this. A small this. And we want everything. And so we're not creating the wealth. You cannot distribute the wealth unless you have created it. Because if you haven't created it and you've got wealth and you give it away, you can only do it once. If I have 100, I give you 50. We both have 50, and you can only do it once. So how are we creating wealth in our country? Well, once upon a time in the Western Cape, we were the premier site in the world for making suits, these suits. We can't sell them anymore to the rest. Because China is making suits. India's making suits. Brazil is making suits. They make it cheaper and better than ours. And when the person sits there and says, I want to build a factory to make suits, where do I build it? Okay, let's look at the different countries. So we might put this money. Ooh, Africa. South Africa. What do we know about South Africa? People work hard there. All the night. They are energetic. They're true. We are hugely efficient in this country. We can't hold our own against those people. So, TB. Infant mortality. HIV prevalence. Malaria. What does that say? What does that say? Each one of those can be dealt with through knowledge. Each one of those can be dealt with through knowledge and change of behavior. Everyone. But yet we've succumbed to all of them. So there's something desperately needed in our country if we are to make a success of ourselves. If there is to be a good future, something must happen, and it must happen fast. And you're going to be right at the heart of making that happen. Here again, you can see church in Romans, sub-Saharan Africa, look at the rest of the world. You can see poverty, the red, the poorest, the browns, the tongues, the oranges, the least developed. Per capita, per income, per person, income per person, that's sub-Saharan Africa. That's the rest of the world. Do you now understand? Are you beginning to stand and see and understand? That any dreams you have of a wonderful future, because South Africa is solid and right up there with the rest of the world, forget it. It can become that, and it can become that very quickly. Because you see, this is the wonder of it all. This is the wonder of it. That we are humans, are cultural creatures. What do I mean by that? We become what our culture is. And if our culture says we can become a great football nation, it will do everything it can possibly can to do that. You will get to know what those people eat, how they train, everything else, and then pass it. So we can be whatever we want to be, and we can be tomorrow. If every South African went to bed tonight and got up tomorrow and said, we're committing to the knowledge project. We've got to change those maps, otherwise there is no possible future for us. This country would be a totally different country. Children would go to school and learn to go to school, ready and willing and able to participate. Spoke to a lady last night, a passionate teacher, leaving teacher. She's 62 years old, still has lots of energy, but she's leaving. And I said, why? She said, because a 10-year-old child told me to go and fuck off. There's something desperately wrong in our nation. And you've got to be the ones. You've come through it. You've worked your way through it. Whatever your background is, where you come from, where you live, what you had available to you, somehow you've worked through, you've shown your resilience, that you have a sense of purpose, that you have courage, and because you have passed and you have the marks enabling you to come to university, you have the potential. But understand, you must get to know what it actually takes. What does it take to be successful at university and change those figures? Make South Africa a country that everybody thinks about. Say, whoa, you go to that country, it's got a learning culture second to none. There's such energy, there's passion for the business. I'll give you an example of getting to know what you require. I asked a group of young athletes one day, how many of them thought that if they really got top class training, that they could match the world long jump, the long jump record? And about 70% of them up their hands and said, okay, do you know what the long jump record actually is? They had a figure. I said, do you know how far that actually is? And I'll show you. I'm going to walk you, okay? Yeah? What should I start? Long jump. 70% of them said they could jump so far. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's the world long jump. Can you imagine it? But they were already, yeah, I can do that. If you don't know what it takes, you can do anything until you try to do it. And so you've got to learn, what does it take to be successful at university? Woman called Jeanette and go, African American, 6 foot tall, 75 years old, strength, full of energy. President of Spelman College. Spelman College is an African American university. It's the top university in the United States with respect to African American. And it's the people come out of there absolute stunned, every possible. And she came here about 6 years ago to go around. She saw a group of students that got out and talked to them. She asked the students, how much time do you spend every day on studying? So the one said, 2 hours. So he said, that's nice. How many subjects do you do? He said, 5. I said, okay, 5 times 2. 10 hours a day, that's pretty good. He said, no, only 2. And you saw her face just fall, and it came up a cry out of her mother's heart. She said, my child, it won't work. You can't do it. It is, in fact, 8, 9, 10 hours. And all of Saturday, all of Sunday. The girls must say to their boyfriends, 4 years from now, I see you. I've got another agenda here. We are totally in. utterly absorbed by this education thing that's going to challenge you to the nth degree in the sense that, God, I can't understand this stuff. And you go and speak to someone and say, help me to understand. My son was asked to leave a university, change his subjects in June of his first year there. I was in this university. They said, Jim, we don't think you can do mathematics, and you must choose another. He came to home and he told us, he said, look, I think I'm having a little bit of trouble. He had got A's for maths and biology. A's. There's a little pamphlet on your seats. Let's take it. It's a story about a person who went to university with the best preparation with A's. Read. So he says, I need some help. There's some things I'm not getting right. I phoned this university, explained to you then, and I asked him, someone spend a little time with my son. To Saturday, and they unraveled certain conceptual challenges that he had. And schooling had gone wrong. That boy graduated with maths, stats, economics, majors. He then has a master's degree in computational finance with prescription. He's now a chartered financial analyst. He would have not been able to get past the first year if he hadn't said, I need someone to help me. Just to clear this. And the someone to help is available. Someone to help are available. You're going to struggle. You're going to read that. Oh, that fellow with all of his A's. I just have no idea. But you might be there. You have what it takes. And we believe in you. And let's go. What did a party do? Well, it said we different people, A, B, and C, you black, you white, colored, whatever, and kept us apart. But this is the real problem. It started with how we gave money for education. That was for white South Africans. That was Indian South Africans, colored South Africans, and black South Africans. And black South Africans make up the majority. In other words, the majority of the brain power of this country was not being schooled. Eh? It's a crazy thing. All those millions and billions of brains, because there's nothing wrong with our brains. As every all research in the world says, we have the same proportion of geniuses as any other country. But you must have a certain kind of experience to be able to unleash challenge. So, what happens? In 1986, we get the message about HIV. We don't believe the message, the majority of us, we don't believe it. Where does it come from? It comes from the apartheid government. And we don't trust them. But when you now speak to your brothers and sisters, you speak. They won't trust you because it's you. Not some stranger from somewhere who is your oppressor. But my child is saying, Dada, there is a virus now called that. And if you can deal with it by doing A, B, and C. That's why you're so important to be out there, because you're the voice that is understood and recognized and trusted. You've got to go out there into communities and change the ways they think about education. Our schools ought to be incredible places of learning. They're not. So, yes. What are we doing currently? And so, we talk about it. I spoke about us being cultural creatures. So, every nation develops a sort of a sense of who it is. South Africa once was a nation that said they're going to be the very best rugby in the world. Is that true? Yes. And it became the very best. It also said we're going to be the very best cricket in the world. It became the very best. Because they put a lot of money and energy and effort behind it. In America, they say you must be the best in everything, and if you come second, you're a loser. Second is not anything to be proud of, they say. You must win. So what does that do? It makes you always try to beat the other person. And sometimes you do it in a bad way. But you must be first. You put yourself first. Everything is about you. That's what the Americans. And they go into the schools, they teach that. You must be first. In Cuba, it's very different. They said what our youngest RC, general said, it's a concern about the whole. About everyone. We all work for one another. You are one thing. And so that gets taught in the school. So when the kid does something, then they say, no, that's not the way we perceive. That's not part of our ethics. It's not part of the way we understand the world. South Korea, 1949, they were an agrarian economy. They had no factories. Now one of the biggest per capita earners in the entire world. Samsung. Hyundai, all of those things come out of South Korea. What did they build it on? When they became free, they said, we're going to develop the best technologies we can, and we're going to become world leaders in it. So those kids go to school, and they work hard, and they produce, and they are out of the world. What do we? We had Soweto in 1976. Soweto was an expression by young black South Africans that we don't want this gutter education anymore. We want our own education system so we can also begin to achieve those things. That's what Soweto was. Every day on the 16th of June, we celebrate what those young people did. Fought for a better education system. And from 1976 until just before 1994, our schools were in turmoil, our universities, especially sorry, the black universities were in turmoil as we continued the fight against the apartheid regime for a better education system. Now, if that's true, what should have happened in 1994? We're now free. It's our country. We make the decisions. We should have had everybody say, wow, let's go with this education thing. So what's happened? It's gone the other way. In a recent international poll, we were 141st out of 142. So was a bit of a joke? Or did we betray what was an earnest appeal by those young people for access to good knowledge? Why isn't it happening today? Why isn't South Africa known across the world as a place where people are desperately serious about life, where schools are considered to be holy grounds? Why not? Why can a 10-year-old say that to a teacher? With impunity and get away with it. How can taxis drive where they should drive and they will find it funny? Every day the rules of this road are violated publicly by people who go through red roadblocks or what type of the pavements, and we laugh at it. The order is just not there, the discipline is not there, the respect is not there. What is our country all about? What are we? If someone from America asks you, what's the ethos of your country? What do you stand for? What comes out of it? You'd have to think about it. There's something wrong that's not happening. And it must now begin to happen, otherwise there is no future. And you are the future. But more importantly, the future will be what you are. You've got to go out there and ignite this country. By the way, you first work here, put in all of your effort, 10 hours a day, seriously, with your learning circle. So, just to give you an idea, 2003, grade 8, an international assessment of mathematics. 55 countries that participate, including many African countries. This was Singapore. Singapore comes first. Average 609 points. Singapore. You go down the list, you find Hong Kong, then you find South Korea, we find Taiwan, we find China. It's a strange unit. In that little block there, people of Chinese Oriental extraction, that they are good at mathematics. Not at all. I think God said to the Chinese when he was making brains, you won't be math brain. Of course not. Your brain is maybe as good as it is, and the percentage of geniuses here are the same as in any country. But what they're doing is different. They go to school and the idea that a kid could speak to a teacher like that is not part of the culture. The culture would just say, oh, how dare you do that? Judge me. We love. I once spoke to some African American boys. And African American principal of the university. And she said to me, that the African-American boys are destroying their communities. They're getting the girls pregnant, drugs, gangsters. They're destroying them. 60% of all African-American boys, 60% end up in America, in some way or another. And she said the reason is because they are not respected in this nation. Do you know that African-Americans make up only 10% of the United States? But you think there were more than that? 10%, that's all. There's still a group. There are 33 million and there are 350 million people in the United States. So they said they're not respected. Yeah. And she said, look at me. Yeah, I like myself as a name.
I have 2 earned doctorates. I have 17 honorary doctorates across the world. But in my own nation here, I do not get respect because I'm black. And she said, these boys are destroying themselves. Just look at the campus right there. And she said to me, it will only change for them when an African nation stands tall. When an African nation says, we're going to show the world what Africans can do. And they become great at academic work. They can become great at economic work. They become great at politics. They can become great at everything. They shine up there. People say, wow. And the boys will then take courage from that. Hey, look at us. That's us. We can do that too. And she said, one after the other, as the African nations became independent, we put our hopes behind them. You're going to do it. Ghana, you're going to do it. Uganda, you're going to do it. Zimbabwe, you're going to show us what it means. You're going to become great in science and everything else. And she says, one after the other, they let us down. And she said, you South Africans are our last shot at this. You South Africans are our last shot at this. If you make it, our kids will have a chance. I said, my God, what a burden to place on us. Because our boys are following your boys. Adrian. Because our boys don't realize this is their country that they own. They're not victims here. They own it. They shape it. They make it. They were a kid to say to a teacher, bugger off. That person is not understanding. This is an education project I'm playing with. When kids go on rampage and break down the school, what are they thinking? It's your school. It's your future. So what is our ethos? What is our culture? We must not stop. We must stop. Oh, sorry. Where is South Africa? Where is South Africa? It's in the middle. There we are. Last. 254 points, our average. Singapore's average was at our 95th percentile. In other words, Singapore's average was with our top 5%. Can you imagine it? The average Singaporean doing mathematics is equal to the top 5% of our nation. Do they have better mathematical brains? No! They just behave differently. They understand through maths, you're going to do incredible things to build it up. No, we believe in. What do we believe? Show you. Grade 9, that's 2012. Grade 9, that's 10%. What do we think is going to make us triumph? Do we think that God will always look after us? God will say to us, we're going to worry South Africa. You are a special place in my life. And I'm going to send you all the stuff that you need. So we do this, Fred, Isaac, we're one foot at the top. I'll show you that. That's what we are into. Title, double question, anti-intellectualism, no dictator, dependence, for me, I am what I am because of others, I can't. Impunity, I'll do what I like, I'll steal what I like, I'll live further, I'll be a taxi driver that goes with nothing that I can do. Exception, we are different. We don't have to do other things. Americans need to study 10 hours a day, but not us. I tell you, an experiment run in the United States about 20 years ago. And they asked about 100,000 young Americans, first year, how much time do you think you should spend, studying outside of the classroom in every subject that you do in a week? How much time? So, got the answers. And then they did put it together, they found something quite interesting. Asian Americans, in other words, the ones who come from, here they come from China and Singapore, they said 15 hours for every subject, 15 hours a day, 15 hours a week. How many subjects do they do? 4. 4 times 15? 60. So 60 hours a week outside of your classroom is what it takes. The white Americans said 9 hours was enough. And the Latino Americans and African Americans said 4 hours.
crops up. Somebody actually said to me, they think that the four is past. Let's believe in him.
We are in that danger that we think without deep commitment to knowledge, you're going to pass this university. If you don't watch out, you could be destroyed within the first month. But it all depends on your today, walking out of here, going on your knees, or whatever you do, and say, I'm going to be part of what it takes to make our country great. I'm going to be part of the cohort that when we look back on them in 100 years' time, that the children alive at that time, the people alive, won't say, they let us down so bad. Because you see, you have a title, and you have an identity that very few people in the world will ever have. Is anybody here who was not born, was born after the 27th of April, 1999? After. See, it's just a habit. The majority of you were already alive on the 27th of April, 1999. Yes? Do you know when the day came? You became the first South African in the new republic. No one else after you ever had that title. The first South African. And the expectation would be the first South Africans must build the base for the development of South Africans in the future. And the question now, 18 years after our independence, we've not been successful, our education system is considered one of the best in the world. Our kids' behavior in school is atrocious. Our government, our teacher unions have got no appropriate conception of what is required. We don't have a strong commitment to education. But if you, dear academics, if you shine, and we put this in the message of God, we will swing the entire consciousness of this nation and say, all of us working together and make this a great place. I want to seriously say, come down to making the oath to yourself, stand before me in the mirror, and say, I'm in this game.